Welcome, my dear learners, for this course on Dynamics of Machines. In this module 3, we were discussing on governors and gyroscope. So far, we have completed our discussion on numerical problems on Porter governor. Moving ahead, I am going to discuss Hartnell governor in today's lecture. As we already learned about the classification of centrifugal governors, which works on the principle that the centrifugal force generated by the moving bodies in the governor will be controlled with the equal and opposite force exerted by dead weight or spring load. For example of dead weight, we have already discussed Porter governor, whereas in case of spring loaded governor, we are going to discuss Hartnell governor. Hartnell governor is a spring loaded governor. If I draw the sketch of Hartnell governor, that is, in today's lecture, we are going to analyze Hartnell governor. Hartnell governor is an example for spring loaded governor, whereas Porter governor, which we have already studied, is an example for dead load governor. Coming for Hartnell governor, let us have the spindle like this, on which we have the nut arrangement for tightening and loosening the spring. Let us consider the Hartnell governor sketch like this. Let us have a nut with the help of which I can tighten or loosen the spring. Thereby I can alter the length of compression of the Hartnell governor spring. So let us have the nut like this, and let us have the spring like this. Let us consider the spring. Which is loaded onto the sleeve. Which is loaded onto the sleeve like this. Now to which we have attached the bell crank lever containing the rotating element, that is the balls, on either side like this. So this is a somewhat line diagram of Hartnell governor. In principle, the Hartnell governor will look like this. Here we have the speed omega. As the speed increases, the balls will move outward and the sleeve will lift up. Thereby, the connection of the bell crank lever to the flow of the fuel will be closed, and thereby the speed will be reduced. When speed is reduced, the balls will come towards the axis of rotation and sleeves moves downwards. Thereby, the fuel supply will open up to the main line. Thereby, the spring-loaded Hartnell governor will regulate the fluctuation of mean speed during the variation of load. The only difference is that at the center we had dead load in case of Porter governor, instead of which we have spring in case of Hartnell governor. This is the only difference. So this is the spring and this is bell crank lever. And these are balls which create the centrifugal force during the rotation. The working principle has been clearly discussed during our first lecture on this module 3, wherein which we have introduced the governors to you people. Now let us conduct the analysis of Hartnell governor in today's lecture. In the analysis of Hartnell governor, I am going to derive expression for spring stiffness. What is the expression for spring stiffness of this spring used in the Hartnell governor in today's lecture? Now, as I said, when the speed increases, the ball will move outward and sleeve will move upward. And when speed decreases, the sleeve moves downwards and balls will move towards the axis of rotation. So therefore, we have two conditions. One is at maximum position, one is at minimum position. At maximum position, speed is high, therefore the balls will move outward and sleeve will lift up. And in minimum position, the balls will move towards the axis of rotation and sleeves moves downward. So therefore, if I draw the forces for maximum and minimum position of this Hartnell governor, if I consider minimum speed position, let me draw the line diagram of it. If I draw the line diagram of this, let us have the axis of rotation. And consider the mean position. In the mean position, we have upright the ball arm and sleeve arm, which are at an angle of 90 degrees. This is ball arm, this is sleeve arm. Let me consider the mean position first. So I will consider the mean position. Now, as I said, for minimum speed position, the balls will be towards the axis of rotation and sleeve will be moving downward. So therefore, the sleeve will move downward. Let me take it like this. Sleeve is moved downward. Let us take this as O1, and balls have been moved towards the axis of rotation. So ball has been moved towards the axis of rotation like this. Ball has been moved towards the axis of rotation like this. Now let us call the ball arm length as X and sleeve arm length as Y. Let this angle be θ1. So thereby this angle will also become θ1. Then only these two will be in right angles to each other. Here the force acting will be how much? The mass of the sleeve plus the spring load. Let me take the mass of the sleeve as capital M. So weight will be mg plus spring load at minimum speed, I will take it as S1. S1 is the force exerted by the spring at minimum speed position. This must be divided by 2 because we are taking only half of the Hartnell governor for analysis. Now we know the load acting by this ball. The load acting by this ball is how much? Mg. Now from the center of the ball to the axis of rotation, we know what is the distance. So this distance is known. What is this distance? Radius of rotation at minimum speed position, R1. Now at the mean position, we have the distance at the mean position. So this is the mean position. At the mean position, the distance is already known. The distance is R, mean radius of rotation. Hence, let me take this distance, that is R minus R1, as A1, and let me take this distance as X1, that is, let me use different chalk. Let me take this distance as X1. Let me take this distance as X1 for analysis. And this perpendicular distance as y1. Perpendicular distance, let me take it as x1 and y1, which are nothing but the obliquity effects. Now it has been moved this amount, let me call this as h1, that is fall. H1 is the fall. Next, for maximum speed position, if I write maximum speed position, if I consider for maximum speed position, Again, I will take the axis of rotation like this. Consider the axis of rotation. As I said, for maximum speed, the balls will move away from the axis of rotation and sleeve will be lift. Sleeve will move upwards. So let me take the mean position again. Let me take the mean position again. I taken the mean position again. Let me call this as O2. As I said, the sleeve should move upward and ball should move outward. Correct? The sleeve should move upward and balls should move outward. So therefore, sleeve will move upward. Sleeve will move upward and ball will move outward. So sleeve has been moved upward and ball has been moved outward. This is the mean position I have taken. Now, if I represent again, what is acting at this point? We have load. How much is the load acting at this point? Here the load is correct. It is mg plus S2 by 2, mg plus S2 by 2. S2 is the spring load at maximum speed position divided by 2, because we are taking only half of it for analysis. Only we are taking half of it for analysis. And now here the load is acting, which is nothing but mg, and we have centrifugal force acting outward, that is FC2. Here the centrifugal force acting outward will be how much? FC1. Here the force acting is FC2, which will act outward. Now if I represent this again, here the ball arm is X, sleeve arm length is Y. Let this angle be θ2. If this angle is θ2, this angle must be θ2 now. This angle must be θ2. Now what else? We have obliquity effects, right? Consider the obliquity effects. That is, let us take the distance between these two. Take the distance between these two as y2. Now we have the radius of rotation, correct? So in the mean position, we have the mean position like this. Let us use orange chalk for mean position representation. Let us take this as mean position. To the mean position, we have the radius as this. Radius now will become radius of rotation at maximum speed R2. And this length, I will take it as A2. This length, I will take it as A2. A2. Force FC2. And this is mean radius R. Mean radius R. Now I want the obliquity effect X. Let me take it as X1. Let me show it this side. This length, I'll take it as X2, obliquity effect. Now the sleeve has been moved upward, so therefore this length is how much? Sleeve has been moved upward, so therefore this length will be H2. So from the mean position, the fall is H1, the raise is H2. Hope the diagram is clearly understood for you people. If you carefully observe, this is the minimum speed position. At minimum speed position, we have the sleeve will fall and balls will move towards its center. Whereas at maximum speed position, sleeve will lift and ball will move outward away from the axis of rotation. Let me write it properly. That is minimum speed, position. Minimum speed position is this one, maximum speed position is this one. I have written side by side for better understanding. And this is the axle sketch. Now I want to derive expression for spring stiffness. Here the terminologies are small m stands for ball mass, capital M stands for sleeve mass, and S1 stands for force exerted by the spring. Force exerted by the spring in the minimum speed position. S2 stands for force exerted by the spring in the maximum speed position. X stands for ball arm, this one ball arm. Y stands for sleeve arm, horizontal one, sleeve arm. And Y1 and X1 are obliquities because of theta 1 and theta 2, it is X2 and Y2. Apart from that, the forces are, one is centrifugal force acting outward, FC1 and FC2, and weight acting due to acceleration due to gravity because of ball mass, that is Mg acting downwards, and also we have load plus spring force acting downwards. I am taking half because we are analyzing only half of the Artinel governor. Now let us derive an expression for spring stiffness. Now first, what I will take, I will take sin theta 1. So if I take sin theta 1, what I can write for sin theta 1? So sin theta 1. So here the sin theta 1 is opposite is H1, hypotenuse is Y, which is H1 by Y. This is also equal to, from here, opposite is A1, hypotenuse is X. So opposite side is A1, hypotenuse is X. Correct? So therefore, what I will get? H1 is equal to, A1 can be written as what? R minus R1. A1 can be written as R minus R1 into Y by X. Correct? So similarly, from this graph, what I can write for sin theta 2? Sin theta 2. If I go for sin theta 2, opposite side is how much? H2. Hypotenuse is Y, which is equal to H2 by Y. From this triangle, what is sin theta 2? Opposite is A2. Hypotenuse is X, which is also equal to, opposite is A2. Hypotenuse is X. What is the value of A2? It is R2 minus R. Hence, H2 can be written as what? H2 can be written as R2 minus R into Y by X. Therefore, the total height H is sum of H1 plus H2. So therefore, H1 plus H2 can be written as what? Therefore, what I can write? H1 plus H2. Add these two. H1 plus H2 will become what? Y by X is common. R minus R1 plus R2 minus R. R will get cancelled, it will become R2 minus R1. That is R2 minus R1 into Y by X. So therefore, I will get the expression for total height H is equal to R2 minus R1 into Y by X. So this is the total height H. This is the total height H. H. H is nothing but H1 plus H2. I found out what is the value of H. H is R2 minus R1 into Y by X. Now, let us move forward. In order to analyze this, let us take moment at O1 and find the expression for S1. Let us take moment at O2. Find the expression for S2, then I can get the net force. Net force is S2 minus S1. Let us find the net force. S1 and S2 are spring force at minimum speed and maximum speed. Kindly make a note. Now if I take moment at O1, what happens taking moment at O1? Let us take moment at O1. If I take moment at O1, if I take moment at O1, if you observe, one force is this one. So this is causing clockwise rotation. Mg is also causing clockwise rotation, whereas Fc is causing counterclockwise rotation. So Mg is clockwise, Mg plus S1 by 2 is also clockwise. So this is how much? Mg plus S1 by 2 into perpendicular distance is Y1. So Mg plus S1 by 2 into Y1. Mg plus S1 by 2 into Y1 clockwise plus Mg into distance is how much? A1 clockwise, whereas Fc is counterclockwise, so therefore it is Fc1 into X1 must be equal to 0. So what is the expression for S1? I am going to get S1 will be equal to Fc1 X1, that is two times Fc1 X1 minus MgA1. What is the value of A1? R minus R1. MgA1, Y1 should come to denominator, right? Divided by Y1 minus Mg. This is what I am going to get. Take it as equation number 1. So similarly, taking moment about O2, if I take moment about O2, what I will get? This is causing clockwise, Mg is causing counterclockwise, Fc2 is also causing counterclockwise. So only thing, this is clockwise, therefore Mg plus S2 by 2 into distance, perpendicular distance is Y2, that is clockwise. These two are causing counterclockwise moments, that is minus Mg, distance is A2, minus Fc2. How much is the distance? X2 must be equal to 0. Therefore, what is the value of S2? S2 will be equal to 2 by Y2 times Fc2 X2 plus MgA2 minus Mg. Take it as equation 2. Now I can find what is the effective force. This is force at minimum speed. This is force at maximum speed. Effective force will be S2 minus S1. S2 minus S1 will be how much? Mg will get cancelled. I left out with 2 is common, or I can write it as 2 by Y2 Fc2 X2 plus MgA2 minus 2y1 of Fc1 X1 plus MgA1. Hence spring stiffness, you know already what do you mean by spring stiffness? Spring stiffness is nothing but force required to produce unit deflection or resistance for deformation, resistive force per deformation, that is nothing but Newton per meter. Force required to produce unit deflection for a spring is defined as spring stiffness. So what is the effective force? S2 minus S1. What is the deflection? Deflection is H. So therefore spring stiffness, let us call it as small s. Spring stiffness small s is equal to effective force, that is S2 minus S1 divided by spring deflection is h. What is the value of h? H is known, r2 minus r1 into y by x. So therefore spring stiffness will become s2 minus s1 divided by r2 minus r1 whole multiplied by x by y. So this is the expression for spring stiffness by considering obliquity effect into account. Unit is Newton per meter. Spring stiffness is defined as force required per unit deflection of the spring. Newton per meter. Effective force is S2 minus S1. Total deformation or lift or compression is H. We know what is the value of H. I substituted and found out. What is the value of S2 minus S1? That is equation 3 is the value of S2 minus S1. Here it is minus. Now this has to be used if and only if he is asked, clearly mentioned that consider the obliquity effect and mass of the ball into consideration and solve. Usually what we do, we will neglect the obliquity effect and also force generated due to mass of the ball. We will neglect these two. Whenever I neglect the obliquity effect for small deflections, y1 is equal to y, x1 is equal to x, and also y2 is equal to y and x2 is equal to x. That is what we will consider, meaning of neglecting obliquity effect, and also will neglect the effect of ball mass. When I neglect the effect of ball mass, I won't consider the moment generated due to mg, small mg. I'll take mg as 0. That is what we usually employ. That is, if we take the case where in which we are neglecting the obliquity effect, neglecting obliquity effect and mass of the ball, if we neglect obliquity effect and mass of the ball, that is x1 is equal to x2 is equal to x and y1 is equal to y2 is equal to y. If we do that and neglect the mass of the ball into account, then what is the value of s1? S1 will become 2 by y fcx, fc1x minus mg. S2 will become 2 by y2 fc2x minus mg. This will become y. So it is nothing but 2fc1 x by y minus mg, 2fc2 x by y minus mg. When I take the difference, mg will get cancelled. So cancel of mg a1, mg a2, 2 by y I can take common. If I take 2 by 2 into x by y, if I take common, what I left out with? Fc2 minus fc1. So in such cases, what is the value of s2 minus s1? S2 minus s1 will become x by y, you take common. 2x by y, if I take common, I left out with fc2 minus fc1. So s2 minus s1 will become fc2 minus fc1 times 2x by y. 2x by y. 2x by y. Now if I substitute for spring stiffness s will be s2 minus s1 by h. This is what s2 minus s1. S2 minus s1 is fc2 minus fc1. Fc2 minus fc1 into 2x by y divided by h. H is what? R2 minus r1 into y by x. Into y by x. So therefore what I will get? Spring stiffness. Hence the spring stiffness s will be equal to fc2 minus fc1 divided by r2 minus r1 into 2x square by y square into 2x square by y square. So this is the spring stiffness expression we use. Always use this equation, that is neglecting the obliquity effect and mass of the ball. Y1 is equal to Y, X2, X1 is equal to X. Neglect mass of the ball. Then what you are left out with? 2 S2 minus S1 is equal to 2 times X by Y FC2 minus FC1. Substitute the net force FC2 minus FC1 into 2 times X by Y. You know what is the value of H. So effective force by H is stiffness Newton per meter. If I solve, I will get the expression as FC2 minus FC1 by R2 minus R1 into 2X square by Y square. This is the general expression for spring stiffness unless otherwise specified to consider obliquity effect into consideration. If and only if he clearly states to consider obliquity effect and solve, then only use this equation to solve. That is, S2 minus S1 will become equation number 3. It is very difficult to remember. If you want to consider obliquity effect and solve, then you should go in this way itself and get equation 3 and then only solve for problems. That is, if he has specified. He has not specified anything about obliquity effect and mass of the ball, then always use the altered case wherein which we are neglecting obliquity effect and mass of the ball into consideration. Now, if I take the centrifugal force equation, that equation can also be written as what? I want to give one note before concluding this discussion on Hartnell governor in today's lecture. That note is, stiffness can also be written as for mean position. We have three positions, correct? What are those three positions? This is the mean position, this is the minimum position, and this is the maximum position. Totally we have three positions, right? Mean, minimum, maximum. Now derivation what we have done is for minimum and maximum. Like that I can derive for mean and minimum, and I can derive for mean and maximum. So therefore, if I do the derivations and get the expression for stiffness, I can equate the stiffness as same for all the three cases. That is, expression derived for stiffness for mean position and minimum position, derived for minimum and maximum position, derived for maximum and mean position. Whatever case you use, the spring stiffness remains constant. So therefore, if I equate the spring stiffness for these three cases wherein which the spring stiffness derived for mean and minimum position, minimum and maximum position that we have already done, and maximum and mean position, and equate the stiffness by neglecting the obliquity effect and mass of the ball, I can also write that expression for centrifugal force as, note, considering the mean position into account, between mean and minimum, it is FC minus FC1 divided by R minus R1. This must be equal to, between minimum and maximum, just now we have derived, that is FC2 minus FC1 divided by R2 minus R1. This must be equal to what? Maximum and mean position, that is FC2 minus FC divided by R2 minus R. This is an useful equation to determine what is the centrifugal force. If centrifugal force is specified, this is an useful equation which is required to solve numerical problem. So this is the analysis of Hartnell governor, which is a spring loaded governor, wherein which we have derived expression for spring stiffness. That's all from this lecture. Thank you all.